We had him here on Friday, and he predicted that it was going to be a 2-1 victory for the Super Eagles. Well, Nnamdi Obanya is here as a sports journalist. Nnamdi.
Morning. Great to be here.
So you call yourself a prophet now.
I'm fond of doing that, but I'm going to be a bit humble this morning.
Okay.
Because of one or two things and comments I got from people over the weekend. A lot of people were a bit harsh on the Super Eagles. Yes, when the match started, the Ethiopians were in control, passing the Super Eagles all about. They didn't have that penetration, but they were able to retain possession, keep the ball on the ground. Yes, the pitch was very bumpy, but the Super Eagles couldn't get a foothold in the game. And what do you expect? They are playing away against a team that earned the right to be there, qualified top of their group, had points deducted, but still topped South Africa, haven't lost 9 games back at home. They are unbeaten 9 games back at home. Could go as high as 11 if you add the COSAFA tournament and all that. They are really strong at home. They even did a bit of false PR before the match. Said that they were sweating on the fitness of Kedebe and Saladin. Released the team list without any of them. Only for Saladin to not only start but play 90 minutes. So that one would have caught anybody's tactics off guard. Keshi, I'd say, had a bit of a fault. He wanted to play a 4-3-3, but I think Uchodo Amadi as a third defender was a bit lopsided because he's a natural winger. So that gave us a bit of imbalance in the middle. So it ended up looking like a 4-2-3-1. Unfortunately, the three behind the one are all wingers. Moses, Uchodo Amadi, Musa. So you had a case where there was nobody in the middle, everybody hanging on the wings. And Ambrose and Ichejili were not in their usual element. So they couldn't give that extra support that allows wingers to come narrow. So that just allowed the Ethiopians to always get possession. Ambrose and Ichejili always in no man's land in the middle. A lot of balls lobbed over them into the inner channels on both flanks. Give us story time in defense. All credit to Obabuna. Emenike will be most people's man of the match. Obabuna was mine, because he single-handedly held that defense. Egweke's inexperience showed a lot. A lot of times the Ethiopians would get behind the fullbacks. And as a central defender, you can see both fullbacks step up and put him offside. But his positioning allowed the Ethiopians to have chances they should never, ever have had. So a bit of inexperience, then a bit of laxity. I mentioned on Friday the 50-50 balls, that the Ethiopians will go for them first. That we had to be more physical, we couldn't afford the extra touch, we couldn't afford to relax. And we did all those things. We relaxed, we had the extra touch, and that allowed the Ethiopians to kind of like get the physical edge on us. They got an early yellow card, which I saw as a statement of intent by the Ethiopians that they were not coming to play in that match, and the Super Eagles needed to also step up. But all credit to them, they played the classic away game football, which is sit back and try to catch your opposition on the counter. There I will fault Mikel again. While he might have had a good game with one or two good passes, if you're going to counter-attack your position, you can't spend too much time holding the ball in the middle of the park, and he did that. He had the ball for too long. Yes, he was winning free kicks, but that deprived us of some good chances.
Those are shots of the penalty that gave us our second goal.
From the moment this keeper made a save in the first half, I was wondering why they were not taking shots at him throughout. Obviously, he's not the best keeper in the world. And if you look at this penalty, before Emenike gets to the spot, he has chosen his direction and he's already going the wrong way. So Emenike, he made up Emenike's mind for him. It was too easy. The same thing with Emenike's shot. Standard goalkeeping procedure. When somebody's moving on the edge of the block, take a step forward. You narrow the angle. But he stood on his goal line, and of course Emenike's shot was too powerful and he got off the keeper's hand and into the net. What we should have done was to take more shots at him. Even so, Ahmed Musa's chance that came off the post when Mikel found him in the box. That shot, the keeper too was beaten at his near post. He wasn't the best of keepers. We could have put that game away early despite the Ethiopian play. Moses missed a good chance 1-1 with the keeper. He wasn't composed. Same thing with Uchodo Amadi. Emenike created a chance for him. He missed that. Funny that both chances that were sitters that were missed were both created by Emenike, who as a striker should have been frustrated because he wasn't getting the support he wanted. But he, at the end of the day, not only did he provide, when he got his chance, he took it, made his second goal, got the penalty, converted it. And I think he might finally be that center forward he's been looking for. Right now, he has joined Rashidi Yekini and I think on Sunday or Yerika on more than one goal every two games. There are only three of them that have done it. Shegu Odegba means flat on one goal every two games. Emenike has 10 in 18. At his current goal ratio, by the time he plays 58 games like Yekini, he would have scored 32. Yekini did 37 in 58, but his goal ratio can still get better. So this is the striker Nigeria has been looking for, prolific, physical, and consistent. If he can keep this form, perhaps we'll have one weapon aside. It's now left to work on the rest of the team.
Let's look at the midfield, because that appeared to be a problem here. How do we solve that?
I think Keshi needs to decide. If you're going to play a 4-3-3, there was no need to have an Odu Amadi. And Ogu, or as you saw, Igebo, who we brought later, steady things. You now have three natural central midfielders. They will stay tight, they will stay compact, they will stay narrow, and allow the front three to spread. You know, then you have one or two people who can sit in front of the defense, and you also have one or two who can launch an attack. Your anchor and your offensive will launch, your anchor and your defensive will sit. That way there's balance. It cuts off channels, because once there's too much space between your midfield and your defense, you allow people to play the ball in the second and third, in the second and final third of the pitch, and that creates problems, because then they make you change your shape, they make you come out, and they find places to drop passes through. When Igebo came in, the game was more balanced. The Ethiopians couldn't get beyond too many chances beyond the midfield. They were able to cut things off. He didn't have the most fantastic of games, but his presence allowed Mikel and Onazi to take proper positions in the middle. When Odu Amadi had been there, he was neither in the front three, neither was he in the midfield. So he was neither here nor there. So he had a bad day, not because he's not a good player, but because he was played out of position and the formation was not right.
Now, there are those who felt that Amobi shouldn't even have been brought in. That coming, in the near future, they should bring back Osazio Deminga and put Amobi on the side. How would that work?
It's possible if you take into account that that's another of Nigeria's most prolific scorers. In fact, he's right below Emenike in the goal-scoring charts, 9 goals. He's somebody who has done it for Nigeria when he needs to. But you see, I think I always respect the manager. You might not always agree, but you have to respect decisions. If he feels that a compact and united dressing room is more important than any individual talent, then perhaps that is that. Personally, I wouldn't mind Osazi coming back. His change of club has brought in a new lease of life to his game. He's found his form, and he's raring to go. A player like him, even Martins, these are people that, even if you don't put them in the first team, will make people fight for their shirts. They are game changers. They give you options. Because if Anasazi had come on yesterday when you were trying to break the Ethiopians, it gives you another dimension. You know, it's like having two Victor Moseses on the pitch at the same time. So it gives the extra dimension. So, yes, I don't mind. But Amwebi brings another dimension too. He gives you a direct replacement for Emenike, where, though not as mobile, a target man that you can drop the ball on his chest. At this point in time now, I think people calling for that are behaving like the NFF, who are also getting carried away. They're already celebrating. In fact, they've lined up a friendly against Italy 2 days after we play Ethiopia in Calabar, and the friendly is in preparation for the World Cup they've not qualified for.
But there's another game with Jordan.
Jordan is for the home-based Eagles, Chan. Okay. That one is Jordan actually wants to use it to prepare for their intercontinental playoff against Uruguay ahead of the World Cup. And so it's more of Jordan's friendly than ours. But the Italy one is our friendly. We're playing at Craven Cottage in London 2 days after we play Ethiopia in Calabar. And I'm thinking,
How close?
Not just how close. Why are you announcing that this friendly is in preparation for the World Cup you've not qualified for? Yes, we did win away. Yes, we have our foot on the driver's seat. But we saw the way the Ethiopians play. They come here, they score one, you know, make us very edgy. This is football. Anything can happen. I'm not saying Nigeria is a better side. It's not a better side. I'm not saying we shouldn't obviously win, but let's not get carried away. Let's keep it balanced, because this is a team that has been together for, what, almost 2 years. Ahead of this match, we were together, camped for about 3 months. They only have 3 players playing outside the country, so they could run the national camp for as long as
our team camped for just less than 2 weeks.
I mean, we had fire brigade camp, so we can't underestimate these kind of teams. We also saw it in the Tunisia-Cameroon match, where the same thing, North Africans, they are all, a lot of them play at home. Yes, it was 0-0, but they had Cameroon on the back foot throughout. So we need to learn from all these lessons.
You know, Friday I asked you a question. I said, the camp, for instance, this short period of camping, and you said, because they play week in, week out, they won't have a problem playing together. Now, but you just said that the Ethiopians have been together for about 3 months, camped together.
Yeah.
So, preparing now for the second leg of the game, what should we be doing?
Unfortunately, these players will return to their clubs in different parts of Europe and everywhere else, unfortunately. So, and the Ethiopians will still be in Ethiopia, continuing their routine.
And having lost this game, they'll be working to come out here. And
the only thing is that that hostile environment, the fans, the bumpy pitch, the altitude, it won't be there. All that won't be there. We'll have the advantage in Calabar, but I think what we need to start thinking of is, I think, satellite camps. What Cameroon was doing at a time, where maybe every 2 weeks or every month, all the Eagles in Europe meet somewhere for 2-3 days, are together, light training, bonding, that sort of thing. Keep a kind of momentum going. So that when you come to camp, it's like you've been going for classes and doing continuous assessments. When you come to camp, you're ready for that final preparation for the big match. So that you don't all come as strangers. You know, so that Mikel understands Musa's runs. Udo Amadi understands how to swap places with
sometimes
Moses.
Musa is left out there with his speed.
Yes, we don't maximize it. So everybody says Musa has a bad day. Musa has a bad day when the ball is not played to his advantage. You need to put that ball in channels and let him engage defenders in foot races. That's where Ahmed Musa is at his best. But you bring him in to play back to the post, passing balls, he's going to try and turn every time and run. And when that doesn't work, we say Musa had a bad day.
Okay, Nnamdi, thank you so much. Your prediction came. So we should call you Prophet Nnamdi.
I wouldn't mind that. Perhaps I'll look into that.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you for having me.
We're discussing the Nigeria-Ethiopia game with Nnamdi Obanya, a sports journalist. But Sunrise Daily will continue in a moment. Don't go away.